Welcome. We'll start in a few minutes. I'm Robert Dujarric from Temple University. I'm extremely happy to have James Brown, who needs no further introduction than to say that he's on the faculty at TUJ. Brevity is a sort of wit, so I don't go through long introductions. Just a few things. If you have a mobile phone, put it on vibrate. Our events are free, but it doesn't mean they're cost-free, so we strongly encourage you to donate. Where is the box? Okay. The box is here, so donate. You can donate before, after, or during the session, and ideally during the three phases. Also, if you didn't get an invitation, give us your business card, and we'll put you directly on the email address. And I just have one question. How many of you are TUJ students? Okay, thank you. We're happy.
Right, okay. Can you hear me okay at the back? Yeah. Thanks very much. Right, well, thank you all for coming, despite the pretty terrible weather. I think in actual fact, I'm rather unfortunate in this regard. Whenever I'm giving a public talk, it always seems to be terrible weather. So I don't know if that's anything to do with the fact that I'm from Scotland, or maybe it's a sign that I should give up doing public talks. But anyway, so this evening, I'm here to introduce my book project, Japan, Russia, and Their Territorial Dispute, with the somewhat provocative subtitle of The Northern Delusion. So it's been out in electronic format for about a month, and the hard copy's also just come out as well. So really what I plan to do is to give a bit of an overview of what's included in the book. And it's a slightly daunting task, because I spent rather a long time writing this, and Robert's just been telling me that he's going to be very strict about the timing. So I've only got 30 minutes, so I'm going to have to skip over some of it rather quickly. But we can come back to that in the Q&A. So I know a number of you are very, very knowledgeable about this topic. We've got some real experts in the audience this evening. But at ICAS events, it's also, you know, a bit of a mixed audience. So I will cover just a few of the basics to start with. So clearly what this book is about is the territorial dispute between Russia and Japan, which has its at least kind of immediate origins in the last few days of the Second World War. And it's always described as being a four-island dispute, although it's actually three islands and a group of islands. Now, in descending order of size, these are Iturup or Etorofu in Japanese, Kunashir, or Kunashiri in Japanese, Shikotan, which is the same in both languages. And with this final one here, perhaps you'll help me out with it. What's the reading of this final one? Habomai. Excellent. So you're already much more knowledgeable about this than, in fact, Japan's minister for Okinawa and the Northern Territories, Shimajiri Aiko, who couldn't quite remember the reading of it. You can see there reported Habo. What was that again? Anyway, these are the four islands. And I suppose one other basic introductory thing to mention is that these are significant amounts of territory. Within the English language literature on this subject, it's not always that well covered. I've read a US foreign policy writer on Russia saying that these are small, unpopulated islands. They are neither of those two things. Of course, they have a population now. They had a population in the past, and they're also really quite large, especially the island of Etorofu, which, if it were to be returned to the administration of Japan, would be the fifth largest of Japan's islands. So clearly, we're talking about a much larger amount of territory than Japan's other disputes, the one with Korea over Takeshima, and the one with China over the Senkaku. So that's the sort of basic things that we're talking about. So that out the way, I'm going to move straight on to talk about the origins of this book. And the origins of this text have something to do with my own origins as an academic. So my PhD, my doctoral research, actually related to Russian foreign policy. So originally, anyway, my background is very much to do with the Russian side of this argument. And I wrote my PhD dissertation on Russian foreign policy and on energy issues. In 2011, I then moved to Japan and have been here for the last 5 years. And I mentioned this because it has quite an influence on my interest in this topic. When I first, started looking at this topic, it was entirely from the Russian side. And I was really surprised when I then moved to Japan, and it almost looked like I was examining an entirely different dispute, because the perspectives, the perceptions of this issue are so completely different. What I had learned from the Russian side was that this was essentially a dead dispute. It was a relic of history, and that nothing really was going to happen on it. I then came to Japan, and when there were meetings between Japanese and Russian diplomats, all of the media were talking about whether there could be a breakthrough on this dispute. And I was really surprised by the extent to which there remained optimism within Japan, and also no little amount of determination to come up with a solution. Now, clearly, within scholarship in Japan on this topic, there is variety. There isn't just straightforward agreement on what the approach should be. I've highlighted a few of the different proposals here on the slide. You have some arguing for a more hardline position, saying that the only acceptable solution would be four islands being returned as a batch. Others promote a more kind of compromise solution, talking about perhaps a 50-50 territorial split, or perhaps just three islands being returned, or some sort of agreement where the two smaller islands would be transferred, and then a continuation of discussions about the other two. But what all of these positions have in common is that they believe that the offer of a transfer of two islands after the signing of a peace treaty would be insufficient. This is what's known as the 1956 agreement, a joint declaration which was signed between the Soviet Union and Japan instead of a peace treaty. And as part of this, as you can see on the slide there, or at least those at the front will be able to see it, the USSR agreed to transfer to Japan the Habomai Islands and the island of Shikotan after the conclusion of a peace treaty. But I highlight this because, as I say, what the perspectives, what Japanese scholarship says about this dispute is that this is not sufficient. Further to that, what strikes me as a common feature of the Japanese scholarship on this issue is the fact that there remains quite a lot of optimism. The argument that yes, it might be difficult, yes, it might take a long time, but still there remains a possibility that something more than two islands might one day be returned. And as I say, this was really quite new to me, very different from what I had learned from just looking at the Russian side. And if there are any doubts about the degree of optimism which remains to do with this issue, I think that they can be dispelled by looking at what Prime Minister Abe has been doing really throughout his time since he returned to office after the elections in December 2012, but in particular focused on what he's been doing this year. It seems that Abe has decided that 2016 is very much the year to achieve something significant in relations with Russia. And he made this apparent from the very beginning of the year in his New Year's press conference on the 4th of January. One of the features of that was his call, his suggestion that he wanted to hold a summit with Putin during 2016. And he emphasized this again in an interview with the Nikkei and Financial Times on the 17th of January, again saying that he wanted to really do something significant with Russia, and this was reported in the newspaper, you can see there from the headline, as Japan's Abe calling for Putin to be brought in from the cold. And as the time went on, through the weeks at the beginning of 2016, this determination of Abe to make relations with Russia a real center point of his foreign policy in 2016 just became more and more clear. So in mid-January, you then have the visit from Vice President Komura to Moscow, And this was really quite a notable visit, because he had obviously been tasked with somewhat laying the groundwork for further relations with Russia through the year. He handed over a letter, which was from Prime Minister Abe for Putin. He also met with Foreign Minister Lavrov, and as well as that, he met with the Speaker of the Duma, the lower house in Russia, Naryshkin. But what was most remarkable was his proposal that Japan could speak up for Russian interests, could in some way serve as a representative of Russia within the G7, subsequently presented as being somewhat of Japan playing a bridging role between the G7 and Russia. Now, this is quite a remarkable thing to suggest at a time when, of course, G7 countries have sanctions against Russia because of the Ukraine crisis. But all of this is leading up to a hoped-for summit, an informal summit, which is potentially going to take place before Japan hosts the G7 in May. And the timing which has been suggested for this informal summit, which is likely to take place in Sochi, is the 6th of May. And we have yet a further indication of Abe's enthusiasm to really achieve something by the step of appointing a special representative for relations with Russia. Now, this was a new role, and it was given to Harada Chikahito, former Japanese ambassador to Moscow. So all of this indicates that Abe is really hopeful about having some sort of progress in relations with Russia this year, even to the extent of potentially annoying the United States. I don't have it on the slide here, but there were reports that in a phone call between Obama and Abe, Obama warned the Japanese Prime Minister that perhaps this was not the time to be going soft on Russia, and that it was important to remain in solidarity with the rest of the G7. Now, at least the way it was reported is that Abe decided that he wasn't going to listen to this advice, and instead he was going to continue with his rapprochement. So a big question here is, why is it that the Japanese side, the Japanese government, are quite optimistic that they can achieve something? Now, some of this is a bit of guesswork, but my reading of it is that some of this optimism is owed to Japan's sense of having a very strong legal position on this territorial dispute. The belief that law, international law, is on Japan's side, as is the moral case. And when making these arguments, you see the Japanese government and others who share their perspective talking about the fact that this territory is inherent Japanese land, belonging to Japan for a very long time, and this further being confirmed as Japanese territory in the 1855 Treaty of Shimoda, which for the first time established an international border between Japan and Russia. And this treaty very clearly placed the islands on Japan's side. Further to this, you find within the Japanese narrative a lot of emphasis on the Soviet Union's violation of the Neutrality Pact, which was signed in April 1941. So the claim being that the Soviet Union had broken its pledge, and that this also means that the Soviet Union's action in taking these islands was especially egregious. And another element of Japan's legal position is the claim that although in the San Francisco Peace Treaty, Japan agreed to renounce its claim to the Kuril Islands, the Japanese government claims that the Kuril Islands and the Northern Territories are different things. Now, there's much more to the legal argument than this, but I'm going to have to move on. But the main point being that the Japanese government is confident about the strength of its legal position. Further to this, there seems to be the belief that they can still extract some sort of deal from Russia because of Japan's economic leverage. If you read articles in the Japanese media about this issue, often it's emphasized the idea that Russia needs Japan in order to develop its Far East, in order to modernize its economy, and in order to diversify away from its reliance on oil and gas. So the suggestion being that Japan, in a way, can hold back this economic leverage, hold back this offer of increased investment in return for political or territorial concessions. And a final thing, which is often presented as being a source of Japanese leverage, is the idea that below the surface, Russia is deeply concerned about China's rise and at some point will be interested in balancing against China by building closer relations with Japan. Again, much more can be said about this, but I need to kind of move on. Very happy to come back to this in Q&A. But my purpose in the book is really to try and understand whether there are genuine grounds for optimism, whether this belief in leverage, whether this belief that some sort of deal for more than two islands is possible actually has any grounding. And my conclusion, as you can kind of see on the slide there, is that no, there is no genuine grounds for optimism. And my reading of the situation is that in many ways, the reason why there remains so much optimism amongst many in Japan is actually a misunderstanding of how this issue is seen within Russia. A lack of comprehension about the importance of many of the aspects of this dispute to the Russian population and to Russian ministers. So what I hope to have done in the book is to present a detailed account of how this issue is understood from a Russian perspective, thereby encouraging a greater understanding of the real possibilities of a solution. And I believe that it is justified to concentrate in this way on the Russian side, because after all, the only way that Japan can actually succeed in getting any territory back is if the Russian side voluntarily agrees to transfer it. Japan obviously is not going to be invading this territory. They're not even going to apply sanctions. So therefore, the only way Japan can get any territory back is if the Russian side decides that it is in their long-term interests to make concessions. And is my argument that these conditions are not in place for the following reasons. First of all, whilst Japan has its own interpretation of the legal situation, Russia has its own interpretation. And it believes that it also has a very strong position in terms of both history and international law. Many on the Russian side believe that these islands are not inherent Japanese territory at all. Instead, if anything, they are kind of originally Ainu territory, but as imperial powers were expanding, it's claimed by many Russian historians that it was actually the Russians who were first to reach Iturup, and that with the other islands, it's kind of unclear about who was actually first. When the Japanese eventually did establish control over this territory, many Russian historians make the claim that this wasn't a peaceful incorporation of territory into Japan, but rather they claimed that this was colonization. And you can see the Russian historian Koshkin making the controversial claim that the fact of the matter is that Japanese advance onto the Kuril Islands constituted the seizure of territory and was accompanied by the same annihilation of local tribes that occurred in America with the Indians. So clearly, if this is a widely shared perception on the Russian side, they're that much more unlikely to consider concessions because they don't believe that Japan has a legitimate claim when it comes to history. Furthermore, far from being seen as a stab in the back and the Soviet Union having engaged in some kind of egregious action at the end of the Second World War, it's often presented that the seizure of these islands followed what is sometimes described as being four decades of Japanese aggression. That much emphasis is placed on the idea that Japan had tried again and again to undertake attacks against its northern neighbor and also to seize territory from Russia and then from the Soviet Union. Therefore, according to a widely shared perception on the Russian side, the seizure of these islands was, in a way, revenge for preceding Japanese aggression. Now, again, I want to stress that I'm not making this argument for myself. I'm not even engaging in an exercise of trying to decide what is factually correct. Instead, I'm making the point that if this is how it's seen on the Russian side, then they are that much more unlikely to consider territorial concessions. There are other things here to do with history as well. The fact that the Neutrality Pact, signed in 1941, was indeed supposed to run for a longer period of time, but was renounced by the Soviet Union in April 1945. Therefore, when the attack came on Japan in August 1945, it can't have entirely been a surprise. It was apparent to the Japanese side that relations with the Soviet Union were not entirely stable, and there was a risk of the Soviet Union entering the war. Continuing with legal issues, and I'll have to run through some of this quite quickly, but whilst on the Japanese side, all of the emphasis is placed on that 1855 Shimoda Treaty, on the Russian side, a lot of emphasis is placed on the Yalta Agreement, where the Soviet Union was given the promise from the United States and Great Britain that in exchange for entering the war against Japan, the Kuril Islands should be handed over to the Soviet Union. I've already mentioned the renouncement of these islands within the San Francisco Peace Treaty. Of course, this wasn't signed by the Soviet Union, but it was, of course, signed by Japan. So the claim could be made there that even if this didn't give the territory to the Soviet Union, it made it clear that it wasn't any longer to be considered Japanese territory. Okay, I'm going to have to move on because still on the subject of history and international law, an even more important consideration than those previous legal arguments that I've mentioned is the fact that within Russia, the Soviet Union's victory in the Second World War is a major part of national identity. In my view, much more so than in other victor countries. And this means that any concept of reopening the question of the results of the Second World War, of questioning the legitimacy of the Soviet Union's action in that conflict, is seen as little short of blasphemy. There was the case of TV Dosht, a television station in Russia, that ran a survey asking viewers whether they felt that Leningrad should have surrendered during the Second World War. Because as a result of not surrendering, a large number of citizens died. And just for running that survey, that television station was taken off air. It lost its license to broadcast. And I mention that example just to emphasize how sensitive the idea of the Second World War remains within Russia. So you can see from the quotations listed here that the conflict against Japan at the end of the war is not seen as some attempt at kind of looting territory from an already defeated power, but rather, you can see this is from Mironov, a Russian politician, making the claim that it was actually the Soviet Union's entry into the war that was the crucial contribution to the defeat of Japan. Added to this, within Russia, when you speak to people about the territorial dispute with Japan, people often talk about the memory of those who died in the war with Japan. And the total casualties was relatively high, even though it was a very short period of time. It was around 12,000. None of these were lost in seizing the now four disputed islands. However, there were more than 500 who were killed further north in the Battle of Shumshu. And so as you can see from the quotation there, this time from Deputy Prime Minister Dmitry Rogozin, saying that the four islands became Russian territory after a bloody struggle and have now assumed the status of sacred territory. And I can't emphasize just how important this is. For many within Russia, they believed that these islands could never be given up because it would be a betrayal of the memory of their soldiers. Okay, so that's all of the issues to do with history and international law. I want to move on to now Russian perspectives of Japanese economic incentives. Now, I mentioned earlier on the argument that one of the main hopes for the Japanese side is that they would be able to get concessions by offering major economic investment. But at least according to my kind of reading of the Russian side, that's not how they see it at all. For a start, whilst they are interested in greater trade and investment from Japan, this is seen as mutually beneficial. Whilst Japan has something to offer to Russia, Russia has something to offer in return. So there wouldn't be any political concessions needed in order to secure Japanese investment, is the argument. On top of this, when you read Russian articles about Japan, I'm often struck by just how negative they are about the Japanese economy. Very, very gloomy about its prospects, and having very much the idea that perhaps Japan's best days as an economic power are behind it. Meaning again, that it's less likely that they would want to make concessions. Further to this, and I think this is important too, there's the belief, and this is a quotation from Foreign Minister Lavrov, that there wouldn't be a sudden unleashing of massive Japanese investment if the territorial dispute were suddenly to be solved. There is the argument, and you can see from Lavrov saying it himself, this from January this year. Some Japanese politicians say that if the peace treaty is concluded and the territorial issue resolved, Japanese business will become hugely involved in the Russian economy, but it will play it safe if it doesn't happen. We don't feel that Japanese business is trying to play it safe. So again, this is the foreign minister saying in no uncertain terms that he doesn't believe that Japan has economic leverage. And on this point, if not on others, it would seem that he must be right. If suddenly the Russian side were to return all four islands tomorrow, would there suddenly be a flood of Japanese investment into Russia, in particularly into the Far East? Probably not. The reason for that being that the main obstacle, the main reason why Japanese businesses don't invest is because they don't see it as being profitable and they don't see it as being a safe investment. Okay, I'm actually already more or less out of time, just got about 5 minutes left. So in the time that remains, I'll have to go even kind of faster. But to just tie off that issue about the economic arguments, there is also the issue that any economic benefits that would be coming from resolving the dispute have to be weighed against economic losses associated with handing over the islands. There's also the fact that in recent times, there's been significant additional investment onto these islands. In the 1990s, these islands were really abandoned, essentially. They were seriously neglected by the central authorities, and conditions there became very difficult. It's a very different case now. Significant infrastructure investment has come in, with some of the most prominent recent projects being a new airport on Itarofu, and also a new hospital on Shikotan. Now, there's a bit of hyperbole here from the Russian magazine, Argumenti Nedeli, arguing that, in short, the islands are being transformed from a godforsaken edge to a downright paradisiacal corner of Russia. I don't think that's quite right. I'm not quite sure they've reached the status of a paradise, but it at least does give the impression that they're quite proud about the changes that have been made and the improvements. Okay, I now need to cover security and public opinion. So you remember that there was the belief that perhaps there might be some opportunity for Japan to do with concerns of the Russian elite about China. Now, this is open to debate, but it does seem that the Russian side isn't particularly concerned about China's rise. That, you know, there's a quotation from Putin here saying that foreign experts keep telling us about the threat from China. We're not worried at all. China does not have to populate the Far East and Eastern Siberia to get what it needs, natural resources. Now, you might say, of course he would say that. That he's not going to say, yes, in secret, we're really quite concerned about China. But I think that there's a lot of truth to this. I think that the Russian side recognizes that China has no real incentive to destabilize its northern border, to damage a very strong relationship that it has with Russia, which is useful in the UN Security Council, where they see eye to eye on many issues, and also the fact that Putin, on this point, is correct. Russia will already sell China pretty much whatever natural resources they want. They don't need to try and seize this territory themselves. And if anything, it would seem that in terms of wanting closer security ties between Japan and Russia, it's less the Russian side which is interested and more the Japanese side. At least that would be the suggestion from a reading of Japan's national security strategy, which you can see noted there. And if this was the case already, it seems to have been even more strengthened by the Ukraine crisis, which, as people know, has served to really push Russia and China much closer together. It has also had the effect of souring the attitudes of many within Russia towards Japan. This is a quotation from a Duma deputy saying that Japan's chances on the territorial issue have been restricted by themselves to the lowest possible level in connection with the fact that having joined Western sanctions, they have now openly become an adversary or even an enemy of Russia. If prior to the sanctions there was some logic in holding negotiations, there is not now. Now, this is not a member of the government, but nonetheless, this gives you an indication of the feeling within Russian politics and also within the public more generally about the level of opposition to any potential territorial concessions to Japan. Okay, final few points now. Strategic significance of the islands, the old bastion argument to do with the significance of the Sea of Okhotsk for Russia's nuclear deterrent. The argument being that if it did come to a nuclear war, then Russia would still, even after having come under attack, would have the option of having its nuclear subs in the Sea of Okhotsk. You close off the entry points to that sea, and it is easier to defend the submarines there. Now, some people claim that this argument is essentially outdated. It's more of a Cold War argument. Nonetheless, it is true that as Russia's conventional forces have become significantly weaker than they were during the Cold War, Russia now has greater reliance on its nuclear deterrent. There is also the fear that Japan would allow the US to have bases or at least some sort of surveillance stations on the islands if they were transferred. And finally, the argument that as the Arctic becomes more developed, as the Northern Sea route is used more and more, Russia will place greater emphasis on these islands as somewhat of a gateway to the Northern Sea route and the Arctic. Okay, I'm over time now, so just to kind of sum it up, mention a few final points. This about Russian public opinion, enormous opposition to this. It's a slightly old figure, 4% in favor of returning the islands, but my guess would be that it would be even significantly lower now. Russian patriotism, nationalism are much stronger now than they were a few years ago. And I have I don't think I've ever met a Russian who is in favor of any concessions on this issue. There used to be a few liberals, Grigory Yavlinsky, for example, who argued in favor of territorial concessions. These people aren't of any influence now. Okay, so a final point then. If all of these things are true about Russian opposition, why then do territorial negotiations continue? Why do we get statements from Putin talking about having a hikiwake, having a draw, seeming to give hope to the Japanese side? Well, my interpretation of that is that the Russian side is keen to get concessions from the Japanese. They're keen to suggest that if our relations become closer and closer, if we do more and more economic trade, then maybe in the future something might be possible. They suggest this because they want the improvement in relations, but there is nothing at the end of that process. I don't think that is ever going to lead to the Russian side giving concessions on the two larger islands. Instead, they are going to try and draw out this process for as long as possible, because there is the belief that time is also on Russia's side. The former residents of the islands who were expelled after the Second World War are now getting to the end of their lives. Younger generations are also less interested in this issue. If we get to 2035 as well, with the status quo as it is, as I think it will be, we'll get to the point where the islands come to have been under Russian administration for longer than they ever were officially under Japanese. And last of all, it needs to be considered the population issues within Japan as well. Again, let's imagine that suddenly there were to be concessions from Russia. Putin has, I don't know, too many glasses of vodka and decides to hand over the islands. What on earth would Japan do with them? Clearly, principle is involved here, but pragmatics are as well. These are large amounts of land. Who within Japan is going to go and live on these islands? As rural areas, and in particular Hokkaido, become more and more depopulated, as is already happening, Japan's argument and the leverage that it might continue to possibly have about making a claim to these islands would seem to diminish as well. Okay, I'm sorry for running slightly over on time. I'll stop there and just I think it's pretty clear why the subtitle of my book is The Northern Delusion. But just to explain it, you can see that I don't believe there is any real option for Russian concessions over the two bigger islands. And I'm using delusion here in its definition as an incorrigible false belief, because that's what I see Japan's position on these islands as being. Okay, well, thank you very much for your attention. So to turn this over to questions and comments.
Thank you very much, James, and thank you for keeping it brief and highly dense, in a positive sense. Now we've reached a Q&A session. I promised James a set of highly intelligent questions. That's why he was kind enough to shorten his presentation. So I think the drill is you come to the mic, right? Then you ask your question, and James will lead the question taking because of professor, but Tag is closest to the mic, so he'll get to ask the first question. And then James, you're on your own.
Okay, thank you.
Tag Murphy, the University of Tsukuba. Thank you, that was a really interesting presentation. I'm sure it's in your book, but could you comment on the rumors that Suzuki Munio, who represents the district where many of the former inhabitants of the islands live, was actually working on some sort of private deal or some kind of deal with the Russians, and that he so irritated the Japanese policy establishment that they effectively used the traditional means of destroying ambitious politicians, which is to create some kind of scandal that would disqualify him. Could you talk about that whole incident?
Mm. Well, there are various different stories about possible kind of breakthroughs, possible deals that were discussed. And these mostly focus on the period when the Soviet Union was coming to its end, and essentially there was preparation for an attempt to purchase the islands. My understanding, though, is that that wasn't associated with Suzuki Munio. It was rather associated with other figures. There was the belief that maybe a deal could be done, but when it was presented to Gorbachev, he was insulted by even the suggestion that he would sell Soviet territory, and he immediately shut down that possibility. So I don't think that that was ever viable as a possibility. It was rather kind of excessive hopes from the Japanese side. Okay, yes, at the back, please.
My name is Gregory Clark. Just to partly answer the previous question, there were four people involved: Panov, the Russian ambassador, Togo Kazuhiko, and Suzuki Munio. And this in the under Prime Minister Mori, there was an attempt to. Oh, Togo is here. Sorry, we have the person involved. But anyway, it all came to an end when Mori, Prime Minister, was replaced by Koizumi. And all the people involved got in trouble. I saw Panov in Moscow quite recently, and he has given up all hope of any agreement or concession being reached. Mm-hmm. My question is, in your listing the legality of the Japanese claim, you, for some reason, you omit the Nishimura statement of October 19, 1951. Mm-hmm. In the Diet, the Foreign Ministry Legal Bureau Chief questioned whether the Kuril Islands renounced in the San Francisco Treaty included Etorofu and Kunashiri, got up and said, yes, they were included. Mm-hmm. So that puts an end to any argument that they were separate from the Kurils, mm-hmm. which Japan did definitely renounce at San Francisco. Have I got it wrong? Or?
No. That's right. So, I mean, I'll mention first of all.
Why didn't you mention that statement? That statement is very, very important.
Yeah, and it's in the book, as is the fact that Prime Minister Yoshida, at the San Francisco conference, referred to the Kuril Islands as including Etorofu and Kunashiri. So, essentially, it's one of the weakest parts of Japan's legal claim, is its kind of claim that the Northern Territories are an entirely distinct entity from the Southern Kurils. You can make that claim potentially with the two smaller islands, but the claim that the two bigger islands are distinct from the rest of the Kuril chain, it doesn't stand up. And there's very clear kind of documentary evidence which shows that that isn't the case, and that's within the book. But yeah, you're right, it is important to mention. I mean, as for the kind of going back to the issue to do with purchasing the islands, that was the issue which TAG raised. Now, there are two distinctive things. There certainly was the case that a group within the Foreign Ministry of Japan were involved in an attempt to make a breakthrough on this issue, but they weren't involved in an attempt to purchase the islands. I mean, since we have Ambassador Togo here, I mean, he was one of the people involved, but my understanding of it is that they weren't attempting to purchase the islands. They were looking for a new way to compromise on the territorial dispute. Okay, further questions, please. Brooke.
Hi there, it's a little tall. Can I just take it off?
You should be able to tilt it down, I think.
Thank you. Okay, so before you mentioned, or what you just didn't, but before you mentioned that that Japan wanted to, I can say this well enough. that Japan feels that they have claim to the four islands due to the signing of a treaty saying that Russia would give them back. Would you say that part of the prolonging process at the conclusion of signing a peace treaty, that they would hand them over to Japan? However, would you say that part of the delay process is due to they don't want to hand them back at all? like they're prolonging the signing of the conclusion of a peace treaty to the Russo-Japanese War.
Yeah, okay, so just to clarify this a little bit, so the Russian side essentially is happy to sign a peace treaty. It's the Japanese side that doesn't want to because of the lack of resolution of the territorial dispute. So if there were to be a signing of the peace treaty, after that, the Russian side, at least in 1956, said that they would be willing, as a gesture of goodwill, to transfer the two smaller islands. But given that that is not just to be sufficient for the Japanese side, that's why a peace treaty has not been signed. And in a way, the Second World War between the two countries has not been brought to a full conclusion. This doesn't mean that the two countries are at war. That was ended in the 1956 joint declaration. But it does mean that there's not a full peace treaty between the two. Okay, thank you. Please.
My name is Sven Usberg. Thank you very much for a very interesting presentation. I'm wondering, since you now have put forward many arguments against the Japanese optimism, why this delusion? Obviously, there's a lot of very highly intelligent people in the government, but still, why does Abe, Prime Minister Abe, do all these efforts in, you know, courting President Putin and trying to get the Russians aboard?
Thank yeah, you. No, it's a very important question. I mean, why in particular does Abe seem to think that he has the possibility to make a breakthrough? And I've had this discussion with a number of people. Some people say he doesn't really believe that there's a possibility. It's just for domestic consumption. I differ on that. I think he really does believe that he can be the one to end this dispute, that he is a particularly ambitious political leader, as we all know. He has significant self-confidence. And in addition, he's had quite a lot of successes as a leader in terms of foreign policy. And I think that he believes in his relationship with Putin. They have met a huge number of times. He likes to talk about their relationship of personal trust. And I think that he believes that he can get some sort of deal. I believe that he's wrong about this, but I do think that it's a genuine belief. Because the alternative is that he's doing it just for domestic consumption, but I don't think that makes sense. Because it's not that much of a vote winner in Japan. Of course, there are people who feel very strongly about this. But at the same time, a survey by the Cabinet Office suggested that now, actually, the Japanese public care more about the Takeshima dispute than they do about the Northern Territories, despite the fact that there's much more territory involved. Also, I was looking recently at the figures of the membership of the League of former residents of these islands. And the third generation of islanders, only 1% of those people are actually members of this campaign organization. So even those who have a direct connection with this dispute don't seem to be that politically active. So I don't think it's domestic calculation. I think that Abe really believes that he can make a deal. And that's a lot to do with his personality as a politician. Please.
So I might not be remembering completely correctly, but it seems to me that when Japan joined in on the sanctions against Russia, that they were comparatively very soft. I mean, I don't think they even announced the companies they were sanctioning, but I could be wrong about that, but I just sort of remember that in the back of my mind. So if that is in fact the case, that they were comparatively soft, in implementing and joining in on those sanctions, is that a leverage point? And how much against the G7 would they push back perhaps in trade for some concessions on the island, because that's about the only leverage that I can think that they might actually hold were they willing to go against the, you know, the G7 and say, well, we could rethink those sanctions if you were willing to have those discussions.
Yeah, thanks very much. So yeah, my interpretation of it is the sanctions were incredibly weak, that when these were being introduced, Japan really dragged its feet over it. They introduced the sanctions later, and many of them were almost, you know, deliberately designed to have no effect whatsoever. They've been described as quasi-sanctions, and I think that's about right. And it was very clear that that was a sign of Japan not wanting, or the Abe administration, not wanting to give up on the gains that they felt that they'd made between the end of 2012 and 2014. So they went along with the G7 policy of introducing sanctions, but they also strongly signaled to the Russian side that we're not really that keen on these. And also around that time, there were two trips which were carried out by Yachi Shotaro, the secretary of the National Security Council in Japan. And it seemed to me that this was a way of the Abe administration sending a message to Russia that we're still keen on close relations, we're having to introduce these sanctions, but we're not really that keen on them. And this message, at least to begin with, seemed to be taken up by the Russian side, because there were a number of Russian politicians, including Sergei Naryshkin, saying that he considered Japan's policy essentially to be a sign of Japan having been blackmailed by the United States into introducing the sanctions. On to the second bit of your kind of question, whether this could be Japanese leverage, that the Japanese side could say, we will drop the sanctions in exchange for some sort of territorial concessions. Well, that might be a part of Mr. Abe's hopes, but it's not really much leverage when the sanctions are known by everyone to be so soft.
The other part of that is, can they ratchet them up if there are no concessions?
Well, they potentially could, but I don't see any signs that they're willing to do that. The sanctions, of course, are not related to the territorial dispute directly. They're related to the Ukraine crisis. But no, I don't think that this, at least, is going to be a successful source of leverage for Japan. I should add one quick qualifier, that although the sanctions haven't had a direct impact because they've been designed that way, they have changed the atmosphere in trade between Russia and Japan. There seems to be a particular hesitancy, I suppose it's always there with Japanese businesses investing in Russia, but at the moment they're definitely holding off because of the sanctions situation. That's not because they're not allowed, they're kind of legally prevented from investing in Russia, it's just that they're a little bit hesitant at the moment. But again, that's not to do with the territorial dispute directly. I think you were first, actually. Yeah, please.
Hello. My question is about the demographics of the islands in question, as far as their population-wise and their opinions as far as national identity and how they identify as, do they identify ethnically as Russians or as Japanese? And do they have any say in this dispute, or are they connected to any of the, do they have any channels of communication between the national political leaders?
Yes. Thank you very much. Okay, so with the islanders, that there was a population of the islands at the end of the Second World War of about 17,000 of Japanese citizens. They were expelled entirely from the islands, and those who came in were citizens, to begin with, of the Soviet Union, now citizens of the Russian Federation. So everyone who is there now is essentially a Russian citizen. You also asked, however, about their views, their national identity. Now it's really quite straightforward. They see themselves as being Russian and want to remain part of the Russian Federation. However, there was a period of time during the 1990s when especially on Shikotan, there were some surveys which suggested that the economic situation was so difficult there that, at least for a while, there was a potential majority in favor of leaving the Russian Federation and joining Japan. That's no longer true. Recent surveys suggest that an overwhelming majority want to remain with Russia. Do they have influence? Yes, I think they do, because when Russian politicians go to these islands, the islanders often ask them, are you going to make any concessions, and pressure ministers into making comments saying, no, we're not going to. So, most famous example is Dmitry Medvedev. He went to the islands both when president and prime minister, and during his first trip, he said, we are not going to give away an inch. And thereby looking to satisfy some of the islanders' concerns. Thank you. And this gentleman here, yes.
Hi. Could you mind commenting on the 1875 Kuril-Sakhalin exchange treaty between Japan and then the Russian Empire? And how it is perceived in Russia right now, probably not perceived as anything, but anyway, I want confirmation. Why that is not a very big issue in the Japanese domestic political scene, except by the JCP.
Okay, thank you. Just before I get to that, I realized that I missed one bit in my answer to the previous question, which is the population of the islands at the moment, which is about 16,500 and has been increasing by about 2 or 3% over the last few years. There is also a plan to boost the population of these islands further. Clearly, this is part of Russia's plan to, you know, develop the region and also cement Russian control over the islands. Moving on to the next question then. So with the 1875 St. Petersburg Treaty, which was a swap agreement, where the previous situation of having essentially shared sovereignty over Sakhalin was switched to a situation where Japan gained control over the full Kuril chain and Russia got control of Sakhalin. Now, it is an interesting agreement. I think that it doesn't really receive that much attention within Russia because, again, they're not so concerned about the specifics of the islands when it comes to legal issues during the 19th century. What is more important for them is what happened with the Second World War. But when that treaty is brought up, it's often mentioned as a potential model for if the islands were to be transferred, because there were arrangements which were made to allow residents to remain in that territory if they so wished to. So sometimes it's been suggested that if these islands were returned to Japanese sovereignty, Russian residents could remain on the islands and be granted some sort of special status to continue to kind of use Russian, to kind of live in the way that they want to. So that is the main relevance of it. It doesn't seem to get much more mentioned than that. Okay. Togo-sensei.
I first of all thank Professor Brown for extensive and detailed and well-researched presentation. I might like to offer one comment.
Certainly.
A little bit long comment.
Okay.
And then one question. I think the legal argument and the moral argument you have presented are all valid. But in my recollection, these arguments were thoroughly exchanged 20 years ago, before Gorbachev's visit, in the seventh round of the peace treaty working groups. And after Gorbachev's visit in 1991, in 1993, Yeltsin's visit, in particular in the relationship between Prime Minister Hashimoto and Yeltsin in the latter part of the 1990s, there emerged a totally new approach to for the resolution of the territorial issues. And that approach is that we should base on a mutual trust, leaders networking, bureaucrat networking, and a sense of and a mutual understanding that taking out this issue out of the bilateral relations are in the best interest of the two countries. And this is very different from the formal legal and moral argument. And on that basis, I think there emerged gradually a kind of mutual sharing of what kind of concrete solution can we really have. And in rough manner, I think now we can call it 2+α. So the options you have outlined at the beginning, 4 islands in a bunch, 3 islands, or the partition into 2. I don't think this really even exists in the real mind of our policymakers. It's 2, based on 1956 Joint Declaration, and something alpha, which is related to Kunashiri and Netorofu. But the main point that the two governments have never, ever discussed alpha. This is present day situation. So my question, on March the 1st, 2012, Putin made, in my view, a historic press conference. You have not mentioned it in your initial presentation. But he said to the 8 journalists of the 8 countries that when I'll be elected as president again, then I want to do 2 things with Japan. One is a real enhancement of economic relations, and another is the resolution of the territorial issue based on the principle of draw. And as you know well, he used the judo word, hikiwake. Now, my question to you, do you think Putin had anything meaningful when he said publicly that when he be elected as a president, he will is prepared to resolve the issue on the basis of draw? In your view, what is this draw? In my view, the draw is what I called 2+α. And the point, 2 is fairly obvious. It's written in 1956 Joint Declaration. But Japan has, at least from our point of view, every reason to ask for the 2 larger islands, but is clearly in recognition that this will not be an easy thing, and more importantly, alpha is diminishing. Time is for the running for the Russians, and from early 1990s to this day, alpha is diminishing. And I have never talked this to Prime Minister Abe, but I think that my fellow colleagues in the Foreign Ministry have a clear recognition that alpha is diminishing. On that basis, don't you think that I thought that there was a possibility of real talks in 2013. But my view that after the expulsion of the new Ukraine issue, now there's no hope. So I am very pessimistic, like Ambassador Panov. I am very pessimistic. But what is your view? Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. I suppose the easiest bit to answer of that is what was meant, in my view, by Putin's statement in March 2012 about hikiwake. What did he mean? I think that he meant no more than 2 islands. He has said on a number of occasions that he is willing to uphold the 1956 agreement. I don't think he means 2+α. I think he means 2+ nothing. And he has said that this is based on his legal background. He talks up the fact that he has legal training, and he says that he believes that the Soviet Union and Japan made this agreement. It was ratified by both legislatures, and therefore Russia, as the successor state to the Soviet Union, is bound by that agreement. But whilst you mentioned that, you know, alpha is fading, alpha is diminishing, I think alpha has already gone. I think that the maximum that the Russian side would agree to, and even this would be a push, which would be the transfer of the Habomai and Shikotan. Unless, that is, you interpret alpha as being really so minimal. It could certainly be Japanese involvement on those islands. The Russian side has said again and again, if Japanese businesses want to be involved on those islands, they are free to do so. That we would welcome their involvement in joint projects to develop these islands. But that leaves absolutely untouched the issue of sovereignty. I think we've now reached the stage in Russian-Japanese relations where the Russian side will not consider any compromise whatsoever on the sovereignty of these two islands. And so Alpha is either absolutely minuscule or it's gone altogether, is my view. Please.
Thank you, James, for the presentation. I wanted to ask you, obviously there are island disputes as well in the South China Sea and a lot of territorial issues there. And, you know, we hear a lot of discussion around exclusive economic zones, United Nations laws of the seas, et cetera. I was just wondering if you know, do these come into play in this particular instance because they postdate a lot of the treaties that you mentioned. I also just wanted to reference your article in the Asia-Pacific Journal where you said that Prime Minister Abe wasn't very happy with the way the Ministry of Foreign Affairs had dealt with this issue. I wonder if you could just elaborate on that. And thirdly, I just wanted to ask you as well, I mean, Abe seems to be taking a huge political risk here because you seem to be suggesting that he will come home empty-handed from Sochi. And, you know, as regards North Korea as well, he has failed in that instance to make any meaningful impact in terms of bringing home any of the Japanese. So I was just wondering if you could elaborate on, answer some of those questions. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Okay, so first of all, the issue to do with exclusive economic zones, it does have a role here, in particular because it has been used by some on the Russian side as a potential way of wiggling out even of the 1956 agreement. So with the introduction of UNCLOS, I can't remember the year, was it 72 or something, UNCLOS? But anyway, the UN Convention on the Law of the Sea, which introduced much of the maritime law to do with exclusive economic zones, some on the Russian side claim that that was a fundamental change which therefore freed the Soviet Union and therefore Russia of its commitments under the 1956 agreement. I don't think that's a very good argument, but it has been raised by a number of different writers. It was actually included in an article within the Российская газета, which is the Russian government's own newspaper. And I think that's important because whilst I'm not quite sure it's a very good legal argument, it shows the fact that even the suggestion of a transfer of two islands is under threat and has a lot of opposition within Russian politics. That is the only real way in which I've seen EEZs being kind of mentioned, other than, I suppose, the argument that if Russia were to give up these islands, it would give Japan an EEZ extending into the Sea of Okhotsk, which they would want to avoid, obviously. Especially because a few years ago, Russia succeeded in getting full control over all of the Sea of Okhotsk. Prior to that time, there was a space in the middle of the sea, which was often described as the peanut hole, which remained as international waters. So there are a few things which relate to this issue to do with EEZs. Moving on to your next question about Abe and MOFA. My reason for raising that in the article in the Asia Pacific Journal is because traditionally the Ministry of Foreign Affairs has had the reputation of being particularly uncompromising on the territorial issue. That some, such as former Prime Minister Mori, have complained in some of their writing about the Ministry of Foreign Affairs, or at least some of the diplomats, repeating the claim of four islands as a bunch, almost as if it were a sort of chant. And so one possibility is that Abe wants to have a particular control over this issue because he wants to take a more compromising position than some within the Ministry of Foreign Affairs. And added to that, and this is really just a kind of anecdote to which I don't really have any hard evidence, but I've been told that there are two main issues that Prime Minister Abe has real interest, particular interest, in personally handling when it comes to foreign policy, one of which is North Korea and the other is relations with Russia. He wants to have much more of a hands-on control over that and to somewhat minimize MOFA's influence. But as I say, I don't have any hard evidence. That was just a comment that was made to me. Last of all, what if Abe doesn't come back with anything, as I believe he won't. I don't think there's that much of a risk, actually, because the Russian side won't just say no. They won't say there's no chance of a deal, because as I said, they want to get concessions out of Japan. So they'll say, let's continue to talk about this further, let's build our relations more strongly, and then maybe let's talk again in the future. So that way, it won't be an embarrassment for Prime Minister Abe, but nor will he get anything from the Russian side.
Even he's got an election.
Yeah, well, also, as I said, I don't think it's a major domestic political issue. I don't think it's going to have a major influence on the election. If he came back with some deal that gave him a major breakthrough, gave him something more than two, yes, that's a complete game changer. That's obviously what he's hoping for, but it's not going to happen. But I don't think that's going to be very damaging to his electoral prospects. Much more important there is, of course, the economy. Any further questions? Yes, sir. Thank you.
My name is Khalil Hassan. I'm Ambassador of Bahrain. Thank you very much for your excellent presentation. My question is, these areas around the island and these islands, is there any possibility for future natural resources be, you know, explored or so?
Thank you very much. I included just a little bit about that, which I didn't actually get a chance to mention, so I'm grateful for you raising it. So, economic value of the islands, we're not really talking about hydrocarbons here. The value of the area is predominantly seafood. I don't quite understand why, but it seems to be something to do with the mixture of currents in the area makes that particular area particularly rich in seafood. So it's valuable in that regard. A bit of an estimate of around $4 billion a year is the value of the seafood there. So valuable in that regard. And also, the islands are quite valuable in terms of mineral resources. In particular, I think it's connected with their volcanic geology. They're an important source of rhenium. Now, rhenium, I understand, is a rare earth which has use in military and aerospatial kind of technologies. So it's quite valuable in that regard. But I don't think this is mainly to do with economics. These are additional reasons why Russia wouldn't want to give up the islands, but more importantly, are things to do with national identity, national pride. Thank you. Any further questions? Yes, please.
I apologize for being repetitive, but in the context of Togo Sensei's remark, the two islands plus Alpha, I think even at the time, we're talking about the Mori regime, that the Russian side, the Panov did have something concrete to offer, or it was included. Perhaps maybe Togo Sensei will tell us what that was later on. I want to come to something much more recent. There's this very strange talk about dividing up the area under dispute, the name of the two islands, so that Japan would get, Etorofu would be divided in half, and half would, and of course, this was supposed to be connected with, you mentioned Yachi Shotaro,
mm-hmm.
and that he was supposed to have put this to the Russians when he made that visit to Moscow.
Not quite that. But he has previously spoken in favor of a 50-50 territorial split, but he subsequently withdrew the comment. He said he'd been misunderstood. But Aso Taro has also spoken in favor of 50-50, but again, he then said, oh no, I didn't quite mean that. But it seems that there is the suggestion that some within the Abe administration at least partially seem to be interested in the idea of a 50-50 split.
Thank you. I was just curious about the origins of it, and you seem to be full bottle on that. I might add that while I was in Moscow, I had access to the top levels in the foreign ministry, and they dismissed the proposal completely out of the question.
Yeah, and I think that I mean, my position on this is that the Russian side won't consider anything more than the two little islands, and even that is becoming more and more difficult. That I think the majority of the Russian population would be against even the transfer of those two small islands, and despite the fact it was offered in the 1956 agreement. And you might say that Putin could overcome that popular opposition. He still has popularity ratings of about 80%. But why would he want to damage his popularity? He didn't become a popular leader by doing things that the majority of the Russian population were against. Yes, he made concessions to China. They transferred 1.5 islands near Khabarovsk. But this was land which was almost entirely uninhabited. I think a few people had dachas on that territory. And it was also really quite a small amount of territory in comparison with the amount of land which we're talking about here. So I don't think that Putin would risk the opprobrium of the Russian people in exchange for very uncertain gains in return from Japan. Okay, any final questions? Please.
Julie Soulier from the French Embassy. Thank you for your presentation. So I want to bring the subject to the politics of defense. So you talk about the fact that it can be the last line for Russia of defense. So it means that this area is militarized, and is the defense system in this area is important or not, and how many bases of this kind of thing, military base, and what is the Russian politic about military for the island for the future? Thank you.
Thank you very much. Okay, so in terms of the military on the islands, they had ended up reducing significantly the presence of the military during the 1990s, significant budget cuts. In more recent times, however, they've been increasing spending and increasing military installations on the islands. However, this isn't particularly a kind of aggressive move. A lot of these new installations that they're building are, for example, better housing, new facilities for the service personnel on the islands, because the infrastructure had become so dilapidated. But there has been an announcement that by the end of this year, the Russian Defense Ministry plans to finish all of the new installations on the islands. And I think in total, there were something like 300. But these are very kind of small things. It's not, as yet, a very significant military build-up. It's rather, as I say, kind of to do with infrastructure. Going forward, however, there are plans to increase kind of the strength of the Russian military there, principally, as I say, because of the increased use of the Northern Sea route. They think that it will be important for Russia to have military assets at the end of the Northern Sea route on the Kuril Islands. Okay. Any final questions? Yes, Jonathan.
Just to go back to your previous point with why would Putin want to risk his domestic popularity and give up the Habumai and Northern Territories island chains? What if it wasn't for, you know, his domestic popularity, but what if it was to curry favor with the West as some type of a rebalancing off of the Crimean Peninsula acquisition? Whereas if Putin was willing to show that he could negotiate on territorial disputes that are, you know, long running, and it would facilitate in Western governments, they wouldn't be able to just point to Russia and go, oh, look, they love to grab land and that's all they're about. It would at least take that one arrow out of their quiver and possibly lead to a potential reduction in sanction regimes?
Yeah.
And is that, could that possibility factor in to?
So using the kind of concessions on these islands in order to restore Russia's international reputation, yes. You mean? Yeah, I mean, I don't think Putin is overly concerned by his reputation in the West. Indeed, if you think about what his priority is, which is remaining in power and domestic stability, confrontation with the West serves his purposes, because you get a rally around the flag effect, that the Russian population is more likely to direct their anger outwards towards the West, to blame it for their economic conditions, rather than to direct that towards the Russian government. So no, I don't think that Putin would be at all swayed by that kind of possibility. Yeah, thank you. Shahat.
Do you think the condition of the of this issue is going to make a difference in the future if both Abe and Putin was replaced by new leaders? Because you mentioned that Abe's personality did play a role in his the way he sees the issue. So do you think new leaders of Japan or Russia would make a difference in this issue? Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Thank you very much. So part of the reason why there's been quite a lot of interest in this dispute over the last few years is because of the belief that maybe the best possible chance of a deal would be under both Putin and Abe. Both of them leaders who are in power for a long period of time, both strong nationalist leaders with perhaps sufficient popularity, it was believed, to force through a deal. So if anything, once those two have left office, it becomes much less likely. It's sometimes framed that in terms of Nixon, that Nixon, as a kind of Republican leader, usually assumed to be better on national security, was able to lead the opening with China that a Democratic leader couldn't have done. So strong leaders sometimes are able to have breakthroughs on foreign policy. So I would argue that if even Putin and Abe can't have a breakthrough, then subsequent to them, when you're likely to have weaker leaders, then it becomes even more difficult. Tag.
One more quick question. Do you think that the what is perceived by many, I'm not saying that I necessarily think that myself, but what is perceived by many as Japanese intransigence over Takeshima Dokdo is related to the Northern Territories in the sense that if they were to concede the South Korean claims to Dokdo, that they would, or Takeshima, that they would undermine the claims that you outlined they believe they have towards the Northern Territories?
Yeah, the two are definitely connected, or other three are connected, that there's certainly a concern that being seen to be weak on one would encourage adversaries on the other one. So the way
it's
usually...
Japanese occupy the Senkaku,
yeah.
Whereas with Dokdo and or Takeshima and the Kirils, then...
Yeah, well, the way that I've seen it presented is being that if Japan were to essentially give up on any serious attempt to get back the Northern Territories, it would encourage the Chinese over the Senkaku. That's often the way it's framed. Yeah, please, yes.
Thank you very much for the interesting presentation. My name is Andrew Zimmerman. My question is basically going back to history, like when Japan missed the date on attacking the United States and declaring war beforehand, the day went down in infamy. And when the Russians declared war on Japan, apparently that was in Moscow when they presented the declaration of war to the embassy and then cut off all the communication lines back to Japan. So basically it's the same thing, that the Japanese were not able to report back to Tokyo that there was actually a war. Mm-hmm. So you could actually argue that the attack on Japan was in that form not legal, and therefore the islands should not have been taken, whether Yalta was agreed on or not. What do you think to that?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's a good point that that the Japanese side were informed, and then yes, they made it sure that, you know, that they wouldn't be able to kind of respond. They also made it so that because of the time differences, whilst Japan was informed technically on the previous day, that almost simultaneously the attack took place. But I don't know. I mean, that's conflict. That's war. That all sides are going to take the opportunity to, you know, give themselves an advantage. And I don't find it particularly surprising that a side who's going to attack another would, you know, not give a significant advance warning. It would be, you know, strange if they did. If I may, I've got one final kind of brief point that I'd like to make, very, very brief, which is my proposed solution to this dispute, which is I believe that before it is too late, before the Russian side says that they won't even abide by the 1956 agreement, Japan should push strongly for the transfer of the two smaller islands with no alpha whatsoever, with nothing additional to that, to just say, let's sign a peace treaty, and in return, we would like the two smaller islands to be transferred. Now, clearly, that's against everything that Japan has promoted in the period after 1956, but at least this would secure some territory for Japan, because the alternative is that Japan, if they wait longer, will receive absolutely nothing. And the status quo for Japan is absolutely the worst possible situation, because they have cut themselves off entirely from the islands altogether, because Japanese citizens are discouraged from traveling to the islands unless it's on some of the few visa-free trips which take place in the summer, which means that these islands have become almost entirely foreign territory to Japan. If they made a deal now, not only would they get the two smaller islands, but they would gain access to the other islands. Japanese people could travel there, in particular those who used to live there, before the end of their lives. They could engage in business, they could enjoy that territory, because the alternative is Japan gets absolutely nothing.
May I supplement your point?
Please.
Yeah, we can't prevent you from speaking.
Because, you know, you have not, you missed one important technical point.
Yes.
In addition to the transfer, Russians will insist that the border will be agreed.
Yes.
For Putin, one of the merits for resolving this issue for Putin is to have Russian border fixed.
Yes.
Because Japan-Russia relations is the only area where there is no fixed border. On that basis, if we can set up some kind of scheme for Etorov and Kunashiri to let the Japanese in, I think this can be one of the minimal alpha. Whether Prime Minister accept or the Japanese people accept, I do not know. Mm-hmm. But the concrete form of alpha on that basis, this is not. This is very different from negotiating this issue in the future. But a concrete form through which the Japanese enters. Mm-hmm. There, I concur with you.
Yes. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Ambassador Togo. We're very grateful that, you know, you took the time not only to join but to contribute to the discussion. So, and we also acknowledge Ambassador Togo, who used to teach at our university. So thank you very much. And we hope you'll come back teaching now that you're in Kyoto. James, thank you so much. It was extremely interesting. We're very grateful to you. Again, thank you all for coming. Especially I'd like to thank the TUJ students. So you're welcome to contribute money to our organization, to the lectures. And also, we have more events coming, including several on the US presidential election. So thanks again, and see you soon. Thank you, James.
Thank you.
Thank you. Okay. Very good.